My name is Feliple Magno de Almeida. I'm from CppCon Solutions, and I'm going to talk about integrating generators and and extending boost spirit X3 for other domains as well. I'll use as an example the CORBA format for binary communication, but that's just an example. And we done that on Spirit V2, and then we ported to Spirit X3 to see how that will work. So CppCon Solutions will work with embedded Linux development, and we also provide training for and consulting on C, C++, and advanced topics of C++, as well as Tizen and Lightman Foundation libraries and GUI development on top of EFL, that's Alignment Foundation libraries. So the overview of the presentation, we'll talk first for the first experiment using Spirit V2 to create a CORBA, a modern CORBA library, and extending Boost Spirit V2 to be able to create other embedded domain-specific languages for format specifications of on that specific case of CORBA communication format. That's the CORBA EDSL for Spirit V2. We talk about the motivation to work on a Spirit X3 instead of staying with Spirit V2, and how to write terminals and passes for Spirit X3, so you can have a more rich Spirit X3 language for with other kinds of terminals you can use for parsing and directives and etc. And this is a work in progress for generators for Spirit X3. So in Spirit V2, we had a Spirit Karma, and Spirit X3 doesn't have anything like that right now. So we started working on that, writing generators for Spirit X3, using Boost Karma as a basis for that. And how we extended Spirit X3 to other domains, such as CORBA, for example. If anyone has any questions, you can raise your hand and I'll call so you can make the questions. You can do that at any time on the presentation. Mobd is the name of the library for CORBA, which we try to make an experimental using CORBA with modern C++, because CORBA has it was a standardized in C++ before the C++ standard, and it has a very awful binding for CORBA. So we try to bring that for modern C++ as an experiment. So first of all, we use the Spirit V2 for all generation and passing of the CORBA. It uses it for passing Spirit V2, for passing IDL, the IDL language, and for binary communication, as well as generating the C++ from this IDL and for generation of the binary communication for communication between CORBA libraries. We also used Boost Type Erasure for object references. So the generation was actually a generation of a concept of an object that was remote. And we used Type Erasure for erasing the static type information if that was a local object or appear as a local object, an object that was actually remote or actually local. So you used Boost Azure for network and the EDSL for binary communication Spirit V2. The Spirit V2, it uses Boost Proto. And the natural way to use Boost Proto for EDSL, for when creating EDSLs, is doing proto transformations. So you get an expression and then you create a grammar that transforms that expression in something that is useful that you can run or things like that. So Spirit V2 has a meta compiler that does this transformation, and it has a grammar matching as a compile time switch case over the syntax. So it, if it has square brackets, it becomes a directive. If it doesn't have a square brackets, it works like a terminal. Or if it has a, if it is a binary operator, it goes to operators and etc. And that's how it calls meta functions inside the Spirit V2. They are called make terminal, make binary, make unary, make directive. And these meta functions is what you can use to specialize, so you can actually extend that for other domains and etc. Both the meta compiler and the meta functions are templated on the domain tag. That's what makes Spirit V2 work on generators and as Boost Karma, as well as the parser, that's the Boost Chi. So it is it has a domain for Karma and a domain for Chi, and the same expression is then compiled for, it's meta compiled with this meta compiler to on each domain to create a generator or to create a parser. So when doing an EDSL on top of Boost Spirit V2 for Cobra, what we did was we created another domain, one for each, one domain for parsing, and another domain for generating for Karma. And we specialized the make function, these meta functions, né? And for that domain, and generated the parser and generator that the Spirit could then later call as a parser or as a generator, or as a Boost Karma generator. So for example, this was the one example of the Corba example. So for example, here we say GIOP, that's the four letters that begins the message. It's a binary communication. And we use these operators because we created a new operator because that, this operator is not symmetric and it works both ways. So it's actually, instead of defining a parser or defining a generator, we are actually defining a format specification, which an abstraction, one higher than creating a parser or a generator. And what we do is we then compile that, this is Spirit V2, to a parser or to a generator. And then we can pass that to Chi parser or to Karma generates function. So this here says that it begins with four letters GIOP. It has an octet that's 1 byte, 8 bits, and then another octet. This is a major version, minor version, and then this is it has a string here, a unsigned shot, and then a sequence of octets. Here we created a directive called sequences, which it begins with the length of how much elements there is, and then it calls as a for the parser or generator that is inside that, inside the directive. So this here is, we have the indentation here that I forgot to. This makes this on the scope of that indentation. Little Indian or Big Indian, because it reads one octet here that says if that's Little Indian or Big Indian. And when it passes, it reads that, and when it writes, it uses the native Indianness and writes that, and then it uses that for the generators inside that scope. So in here, there is an aspect that all the parsers and generators that will be compiled here is going to obey the indentation inside this directive. This is done through the context that is used on Spirit V2 and Spirit X3, where we'll see on Spirit X3 better. Any questions here? So as we saw, it creates a parser or a generator by doing that compile, which calls the meta compiler of Boost Spirit V2. And it allows us to give new meanings to terminals. For example, that GIOP or constchar array, a C string array, this has a different meaning inside this compile here, then it does in directly on Karma or in Boost Spirit Chi. Because since we are going to compile that here, we can change the meaning of the GIOP, because the make terminal for this GIOP consha is going to be called on our domain. So we can change the meaning however we want for every terminal here. So you could use, say that as any already used terminals in Boot Spirit V2 could be rewrote to do something completely different here. It also allows a composability of using, for example, this is, for example, the list operator, but this list operator is outside our domain. So this is actually used as a list, for example, for the chi directly. So I can say that compile this grammar here to a parser, and then use this operator outside that. And then I can use that, use any operators of the spirit chi, using inside that format specification for Corba, for example. So what's the motivation to actually go to Spirit X3 instead of staying on Spirit V2? Spirit X3 is the future because it's actually much, much faster to compile. It's a few orders of magnitude faster because of Boost Proto creates a lot of template instantiations. And Boost Spirit X3 decided to go without Boost Proto. So it has been done a very great effort to make the number of template instantiations and the size of the symbols to be the smaller as possible. So compilation is much, much, much faster in Spirit X3 than it is in Spirit V2. So one of the problems that mobbed the library for our experimentation for Corba didn't actually work out with Spirit V2 is that it was too much time to compile what was generated. It took, we had to work to try to get less than 4 gigabytes of memory to compile. And it was a very hard thing to do. So it wasn't even compilable for some time in 32-bit machines, because it just took too much memory to compile because of Spirit V2 and the time type erasure as well. So there was an experimentation on that, and Spirit X3 then came up with a very much smaller footprint in compile time and the memory used to compile. Our objective is actually to make format specification easy to write on Spirit X3. So when working with parsers and the generators, we sometimes try to think that as a parser and how you use actions, semantic actions and things like that. And for some formats, as Corba was something that we could actually see that Corba was very easy to work as a format specification. And we've even tried that with HTTP with some success on actually defining format specification instead of doing the creating a parser and creating a generator using separate EDSLs. So we decided to write Spirit Karma for Spirit X3. So this is a work in progress. This is not complete, but we're already using some tests from Boost Karma to verify our implementation of the generators for Spirit X3. Sorry, could you repeat?
What percentage of the unit tests for Karma?
About 10%. I think like that. We have some kinds of alternatives. We have sequences, and we have integers, but we have some refactoring to do as well. So even what's there testing and working needs more love to refactoring and doing a little better.
Are you going to talk a little bit more about it later?
Yes.
And Can you just repeat the question so it's in the microphone?
Ah, okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, the question was that how percentage of this unit test is working on the generators for SpiritX 3. So, well, we've talked a little bit how it's better than Spirit V2. One reason, and I think it's the most important one, it's because it's much, much faster to compile. It uses a lot less footprint to compile as well, so you can actually have more parsers inside the same translation units. And that's very, very crucial, depending on which parsers are working with. And it's faster because it doesn't use Boost Proto, and it has a much linear expression template too. Boost Proto is it's very, very generic. It allows you to create almost any embedded domain-specific language. However, the language, the EDSL for Boost Spirit is very, very standard. It has terminals, it has directives, and it has operators for sequences, alternatives, and the EPG operators. So it's not a very, very complex domain-specific language syntax-wise. So it makes sense to go away from Boost Proto and doing the expression templates manually. So we'll talk on SpiritX3. How do we do to extend SpiritX3? One way to extend it is actually writing new parsers and new terminals, so you can actually parse more things inside the same EDSL. And the other is writing generators, and as we go see to how to extend the SpiritX3 to other domains as well. So this is an example of a parser written in SpiritX3. So what you have is that this is a struct, and it inherits from parser, ELL parser, which is a curiously recurring template parameter. And it has a member function, template member function of pass, and it's very the implementation of it is very straightforward. And what you see here is that what's going to be used on the expression template. So you use EOL, and this is going to build our expression template directly with the operators and the directives. Okay, this is not the only way to create a parser that works in the EDSL of SpiritX3. Any questions here? So this is writing this example of the of an operator. So this here makes the substitution failures not an error. So this is really a parser, and as is defined a parser concept, we'll see how that is. Then this can be selected in argument dependent lookup. And then it converts that as a parser and as a parser. On the case that the parser is actually inherits from parser base, which is the case from EOL parser, for example, then that doesn't, the conversion is an identity, so it just returns the parser itself. So the parser concept, how that is defined in SpiritX3, allows us to substitution failure, not an error, the operators, which is important because or else we are going to, our operator is going to leak everywhere. So that's an important feature. And allows us also to convert constants and terminals into parsers. So for example, a C string, it's not a parser per se, directly a parser, but it can be converted to a parser. And that is possible through the specialization of the S parser type traits directly. So it's actually specialized for int, and which returns an int parser, which allows the overload operator for the sequence operator of the SpiritX3 to match the int as a correct as a matching argument for passing. This allows for the for character constants, which is actually int, not SHA. So there are customization points that allow you to make an object to be a pass. So as you can see, one of them is to specialize the as pass inside the name template, the namespace extension, which allows the constants for SHA. And we can also overload a EDL enabled as a spirit pass function, which we can see here. There is an example in the blog where this we define this as spirit pass function that takes a point and returns it the point pass for that. And then when you use a point inside the domain specific embedded language, it automatically is going to be converted to point pass and use the point pass for you. That is done, for example, in all the sequences and all the directives that is going to call spass before building the expression template. You can also inherit from pass base, which is interesting because it enables the operators inside the spirit namespace. So if you have 2 points, for example, and you want to sequence those points, and none of those inherits from spirit from passabase, they are not going to pick the sequence operator. So at least something has to inherit from passabase in spirit, so that you can get the operators from spirit. I use this from this URL, which shows very well how to create new parsers and extend that. Okay. So. I have this example, and there is the EOL parser, which is actually an example inside the Spirit X3, and there is this way as a spirit parser, and I didn't show here the specialization way, but it's very trivial too. Okay, and we went to write the generators for Spirit X3. We had to create then a generator concept as well. So the first thing that we went for is that we wanted to allow a same syntax to build both generators and parsers. That was very important because if you had only a symmetric pass syntax as we do in Boost Karma, then you can't actually use the same code for generation as the same for passing. So that doesn't allow for a format specification like language. So we went for having the same syntax for both. That means that, yeah, the Spirit V2 has this inconsistency between both, which actually makes them symmetric, using the shift left and shift right. So I think the symmetry causes unnecessary incompatibility, so it's not very desirable. So we chose to use the shift right for everything. And that is enabled to use to write parsers and generators as a format specification. So this is an example, for example, this works as is, because you can say that it has an HTTP and then an int, and then more shards. Here actually you have to use minus this one, but that's the idea. So to generate, you can say you can just use the number 200 and OK the stats line, and you create you can generate the stats line for that. And for parsing, you can do just the opposite way. You actually passes what's going to be attributed to. So you can say the same stats line to generate and pass it as well. You're doing the same, building the same expression template. Okay. So we decided to implement the generators in our red developers passes. So inside the passes, inside the SpiritX tree. So we created classes that actually are models for both generators concepts and parsers concepts at the same time. And it has less typing, and it's easier to understand. So, for example, the sharp parser, it only had this parser function here, and now it does have the generate function as well. So this is not a problem because none of those are going to be instantiated unless it's necessary. So you can just use both here. This becomes only an issue because on rules, which we have not implemented yet rules for generators. So when you create rules for generators, the person have to decide if that rule is going to be a parser only, a generator only, or it's going to be both. Because when it has to be both, that is going to instantiate both member templates. And if that fails for some reason, then you have to decide it, that's only a parser or only a generator. And we decided to use the test cases from Spirit Karma as basis for the development of the SpiritX3 generators. So this is an example of the Spirit test that we are using that already there. And we implemented alternative sequences, and it's bigger than that, but this is one example. And when we try to extend SpiritX3 to other domains, trying to use that for CORBA communication, binary communication, we actually confronted a few limitations of SpiritX3. So one of the limitations of the SpiritX3 is that it has only one compilation phase, in a way. It doesn't have a metacompiler. This only phases during the ET construction itself. So what happens is that when you call the operator or the shift operator, that actually does the compilation phase for you converting the whatever is the terminal here directly to a parser. So you can't use the whole expression template, have the whole expression template for then later try to convert for something or the other. And that means that you don't have a context information here to be able to say what you really want. Because the compilation phase, the meta compilation phase was done inside the generate function or inside the parse function. In this case, this is done outside the parser and the generate function. It's done when the operators are called directly. So when the error values are generated. So this is a limitation, but it's actually something that makes SpiritX3 much, much faster to compile too. So it's actually desirable to have this only compilation phase. And we can only extend the terminal meanings, but we cannot give another meaning. Because if the ELL parser, for example, which is the terminal itself, already is a parser, then we can't actually compile that to be something else. It's already a parser, and it passes as the member function parser does the job. The other way, on the SpiritV2, we could just transform whatever we wanted to something else, and then pass however we wanted. So domain specialization becomes writing new terminals and directives that actually apply to that domain specific language. So one example is, I called Parto because it's a parser and generator, but I have to find a better name for that. Yeah, this is for the octets that we showed before. And this is both a parser and a generator. And this is the parsing function for octet pass. So with this, what we did was create new terminals that have specific meanings inside that format specification. That is the generator, and we create the terminal that is going to be used on the DSL by the user. So we actually use context for all aspects that are orthogonal to the generation of the format specification. So one example is the indianness, because indianness changes how parsing and generation is going to work inside that scope of the indianness. Okay, and the alignment is also to obey some scopes, but it's a little more complicated because it has to start from the beginning of the message. So, and both are runtime information that must be kept through on the context for the algorithm that is going to parse and generate. So what we're doing is pretext 3 is actually we just create here an aligned context. We create a new context, make context with the tag of the context and passing the information that we're going to keep as a runtime information on the context. And we use here unused, means that it's actually create this context using as basis an empty context. So this could be another context. So you are going to stack information inside the context, and then you can pass this for the generator or for the passing information. This is done for no case, for example, when you don't care about casing and other aspects for passing too. So for passing, for alignment, as you can see, we pass the iterator for the beginning, because that's information that's going to allow us to see how far that is from the beginning of the message. And we also use attribute matching for format specification. So that's the attribute matching that allows us to see the EDSL as a format specification instead of as a concrete parser or a concrete generator. Because you say how that is layout in the parser, and then it does the matching for attributes automatically. So that's one important aspect of the Spirit, both of V2 as the X3 for format specification. So the attributes have an inherent sequence when passing generates. That's a limitation that I think that if we explore fusion maps and other types of operators, that is not necessarily attribute matching sequential, we could overcome that. But for now, it has a sequential sequential property for the attributes. So if you have an int and a SHA, the int must be first and the SHA must be later, unless you use semantic action. But semantic action is not very compatible with format specification in this case. So it must have a compatible syntax. And the idea is to forget passing and generators. We actually think of that as writing a specification for that format, and then we can just pass and generate from that. So semantic actions are not compatible with this approach because it has different parameters for calling, and you have necessarily some kind of not compatible syntax, because when you are parsing, you are going to make attributions to inside the semantic actions, and when you are going to generate, you are going to get information from that. So the semantic action is not very compatible in both aspects automatically. So for Corba specifically, we wanted to generate a format specification that's actually generic. So what we did was we used EDL with the context type, so we could have actually multiple backends for how the parsing and the generator would actually be called and would actually do the work. So GIOP is the name for generic IOP for Cobol methods, and IIOP is for Internet TCP specification. And there is other kinds of, for example, broadcast IOP and other types. So We actually want to write the grammar in generic GIOP because that's exactly how the standard is written. So you can just take the formation from the standard and write that in C++ directly. And then let the actual backend deal with indentness and alignment that is which is actually specific to the IOP, the Internet Protocol. So we just use overloading at the ADL. So what we did there is that we called Octet Pass here as a non-qualified function call, and we pass the context here. So the context that we received there. And then that's in the GIOP namespace. And then we define the Octet Pass on the EIOP namespace. And then how we make that find is that we just create a IOP context with a tag that is actually on EIOP namespace. So it's actually gets pulled in overload resolution. So it calls our IOP backend directly. And it's very automatic. And as long as we use a very unique function name, that works well. Now, here is actually the correct code for the alignment tool. So we see that you use the IOP context here to create the align context with the IOP. So it's actually a context with both informations, the information from alignments and the information from the IOP. And then later, when you use the indentness directive, that is going to create the context with information for indentness as well, and pass that for the parser and generator. So putting all together, making a call in COBA, that's just that. And we define how our message body, it's the most outer external information, the header for the message itself. It has a raw GIOP. Remember, here we can't actually redefine terminals, so we have to create another terminal here that is going to use GIOP as a raw, write that raw in the in our message. And then we say that's an octet with the value 1 and an octet value 0. So it's a major and minor version. And then we have the indentness. This indentness is 1 byte long, which has one flag that says if it's little endian or big endian. This is an octet with the message type. So if it's a request, it's a reply, and things like that. And this one is a different directive, which actually runs this body in a buffer. See how much, which is the size of the body that was passed or generated. And then it writes the size using this parser here. It's ulong, so it has 32 bits in COBA. And this is generating. When passing, it actually reads the ulong and then calls the body passing on top of that amount of space. So it doesn't go over or less than that space. And for example, it fails if this parser here doesn't set the first iterator, the current iterator, equals the last, so that it actually consumed the whole buffer. We define the request, which is actually it goes just after the message. So it has a sequence of service contents, which is actually a sequence of shards or octets. And it has a unsigned long here with the request identification, which is actually going to be used for the reply. We have a boolean, which says if a response is expected. The object key, which is actually the identification of the object on the remote server. We have the string with the operation that is going to be called on that object. And this request in principle is just some security thing. And here we have the body. You see, the body is always templated here. So you have the body and the body here. On the message, it's the same thing. You have the body and the body here. Okay. So what's the idea? Is that we can actually use, for example, we can say that it's a message with a request and with a string, this which is the argument for the call. So this actually makes the message complete. The parser is composable, one with the other. So I define how our message is going to be. I define how the request is going to be, and then I can create a whole message just using one side the other, and then passing the arguments as well. So this is the args is a string, the arguments. So what to do is to generate, you passing a buffer. This is the is a call, which is actually the grammar for the our call, our request. And then pass the fusion vector, which is going to have an empty service context. It has the zero service ID, request ID. We do respect expect a response because we want the returned value. This is the object key, which is actually an opaque sequence of octets. This is our operation, which is EZA, then an empty principle, and our argument, which actually we're requesting if that object is actually an object, which is always true. So, and then we can just send the buffer to the server. So you can see that we can create the whole message, generate the whole message in very few steps, and actually just have the specification already defined before. So we can actually then send a reply as well. We just say that we have a message with a reply and the return object and whatever out parameters there is. And we say it's a Boolean, we want to return. It's a true or false if it's an object. And then we can generate the same thing, passing the information on the fusion as an attribute here as a fusion sequence. So it say it doesn't have a service context. The request ID has to be the same, it's zero. And the reply status zero is its success. And we pass here the true, which is the actual return value. And then we can just send back through the sockets that buffer that we just generated. So any questions? I finished a little bit earlier. The code is for the spirit generators is on this URL. This is the GIOP, which is the definition for the CORBA parser and generators on using the spirit X3. And if you want to know more about expected solutions, we also do developments inside the Enlightenment project for GUI developments. And if you want to send me an email, that's my email here, Feliple@expected solutions.com. We're from Brazil. Thank you.